And thank you, all of you, for taking time of your agenda to be here and have the opportunity to share this short presentation with all of you, okay? Well, before I start with business, I would like to say thank you very much to Arturo Bretas and Mario Daniel Baquedano. Thank you very much, both of you, for all the effort and the support to put this activity together. I highly appreciate your effort in this sense, okay? Thank you from the bottom of my heart, okay? Also, before I start, I would like to clarify that all the opinions and all the ideas that I present over here belong to me. I'm the university or any other company related to me is not responsible about any confusion or my interpretation of my ideas here, okay? If you feel that I make a mistake or you feel that something is confusing, please feel free to drop me an email, okay? I have a ResearchGate repository. The slides will be stored over there after this session. You can access my ResearchGate over there, and you can download from there all my these slides and also previous conferences. Okay. Finally, the recording of this session will be stored in my YouTube channel. As usual, I record all the events. I try to make clear. Any participant will be deleted or removed from the personal data will be removed and the video will be available for all of you, okay? I don't know when. Let me clarify that probably it will take a while, week or 2 weeks, but it will be ready for you in 4K high definition, okay? Well, it's time for business. We are here to talk about frequency control in modern or future power systems. And before I start, I love to make a context and motivation about this talk, okay? And I use this photo. This photo was taken in the US in early 1900. To be honest, it was specifically Sunday Easter. In the Fifth Avenue in New York, okay? And this photo is basically something that has been used in marketing for many years because there is a clear question that people make, and where is the car? And if you are very specific, you can see that there is only one car over there. The others are just basically horse that they are moving very old technology of cars, okay? And what is the idea of this photo? That later, in 1913, somebody took the same photo, the same place, and probably almost the same time. It was Sunday Easter in 1913, Fifth Avenue, New York. And now, it's possibility of asking you, now, where is the horse carriage? And as you can see over here, if you are very, very detailed, you can see that there is only one horse carriage over here, and the other ones are just classical cars. Okay, this photo is used for showing you what we call market disruption. I love to use this example because the internal combustion engine car replaced the horse, and that was something that happened that not much people was looking after that. To be honest, there are some phrase for Henry Ford that he say, if I had listened the masses, all they want was a faster horse. And to be honest, he create a new technology, he used the internal combustion engine, and he make 100% change for the 20th century, okay? That is something that happened. But probably you are wondering why I am using this example. Because power systems in some countries are like this. We have horse carriage, but now I change those horse carriage for synchronous machine. In the majority of countries, several countries, we have the majority of the power production is coming from synchronous generators. And probably you are wondering, where is the power converter? And there is only one here. And then I would like to use the same photo
But now the question is, where is the synchronous generator? Well, the context is that power electronic converters arrived many decades ago. They are increasing the penetration in the electrical power system in some countries faster than others. And in the future, it's my vision that power converters will be the dominant regarding the power production. And I will show you some evidence in few minutes, okay? Well, what is the agenda for today? I will start with a short description about the paths to net zero. Then I will discuss the transition and what is the issue related with that transition. Then how can we develop a power electronic dominate system. Then I will discuss some concepts about frequency response. Then how we can get frequency response from renewables. I will discuss just few controllers, one of them the famous emulation, inertia emulation, and the fast active power injection, and then some concluding remarks, okay? Well, all of you are aware that we have a massive pressure to reduce the CO2 emissions, reaching net zero emissions. And there is a commitment in some countries in legal way, in other countries moral way. But there are many countries that they want to reach zero emissions in different time scales. Some countries, for instance, United Kingdom, 2050 is the legal legal documentation that is requiring zero CO2 emissions. But however, we have local records. Glasgow is 2030, Manchester 2038, and so on. And this pressure is around the world. Okay, already the International Agency of Energy is already in talking about a path for zero CO2 emissions, and that requires a massive penetration of renewables. And there is a target, a supposed target of 2050, around 70% of the electricity production around the world will be coming from PV and wind power. Now, this transition to zero net requires a massive change. This massive change is happening in different ways and different sizes inside the power system. From the generation point of view, from the production point of view, we are now having more renewables, weather-dependent production with the use of power electronic converters to the grid. That is one of the situations. From the demand point of view, we are also changing. There are many components that they are appearing over there. We have new kind of loads like electric vehicles. We have new features like battery energy storage. We have local generation like solar panel at the rooftop, and also some other components like, for instance, wind power. Okay. In the middle, we have the transmission and distribution system. Also, there are some power electronic converters arriving over there for FACTS already for many decades, for the case of battery energy storage and so on, okay? What I'm trying to tell you is that the system is changing in many directions, and I will focus in this presentation in one that is very important for frequency control, and that is related with the reduction on the physical or real rotating inertia in the power system. When we are reducing the CO2 emission and we are putting more and more renewables, there is one situation that these renewables are, let's say, substituting the classical power plants. We are stopping thermal power plants using coal and also oil. We are trying to reduce the CO2 emission, changing those power plants and installing more PV system and more wind power, and now the energy storage, okay? Many people believe that this is just a history. Well, but depend of the country and the region that you are around the world, that is a reality. I use as evidence this document. This is a document published in 2021. This is a document coming from the National Electricity Market. This is basically showing the statistic of 2018, 2019, and 2020. And on the vertical axis, you can see the synchronous generation. And on the horizontal axis, you can see the inverter-based generation, in this case, wind power and solar power. What is the situation here? Well, if you look the numbers, you can see that the higher penetration of wind power and solar power reached 38% in 2018, but in 2020 reached 52%. That means that in 2020, it was a moment where the inverter-based resources were majority, and in fact, the synchronous generator was a minority. That situation was with 13.7 gigawatts of generation coming from this magnificent synchronous generation. What I'm trying to tell you is that it's a reality. We have situations at the moment in Australia where the inverter-based generation is majority compared with other components, okay? Now, what is the issue? Well, I would like to spend many hours talking about the issue here, but I don't have so much. What you need to understand is that the synchronous machine and the power converters, they look similar. We have been trying to make them look similar. We have been trying to make them work together and be, let's say, work in a friendly environment, but they are not the same, okay? The situation here is that we have a power system with a lot of power synchronous machine, and now we are reducing the synchronous machine and we are installing more synchronous power converters. And the synchronous machine is very, very different compared with the power converter. The synchronous machine has electromechanical process to produce electricity that is very clear and well-defined using some equations. It's electromechanical processes, the magnetic field is involved, and there are relative low number of control loops for making this synchronous machine produce electricity. On the other hand, we have here the power converter. The power converter is fragile, is sensible, is very, very sensible to the electrical quantities. The good news is that this device is basically an energy conversion system. This energy conversion system has some control loops. However, from the control point of view, is a more complex unit compared with the classical synchronous machine. In the classical synchronous machine, the frequency is created without any signal processing, without any control action. It's something natural coming from the basic electromechanical conversion process. In the power converter, the situation is very different. The power converter is extremely powerful in order to make what we want, but we need to define the appropriate controls, okay? From the control point of view, inside a classical converter, what we call now the grid following converter, now we have a fashion name that is the grid forming and the grid following. I will talk a bit later about that. But what we call now the grid following converter is the traditional voltage source converter that is controlling the active power and is working like a voltage source behind an impedance. That is basically the approach. However, in this kind of power electronic converters, we have several control loops. And here, what we need to understand is that the converter must be synchronized to the AC grid. And in that case, we need some synchronizing mechanism. That is what we call the PLL. There are several control loops and so on, but I will not discuss full details of that right now. What I can tell you is that for many decades, we have been talking about issues coming from related with the integration of power electronic converters, okay? There are several issues that we have been relating in the literature. And finally, last year, the IEEE Working Group on Power System Dynamic published the piece TR77, and they decide to include new phenomena related with power electronic converters, okay? What I'm telling you is that the penetration level of power electronic converters are increasing, and there are several phenomena that appear in the literature that require attention, because right now the reduction on inertia, the increased number of power converters, the different control loops coming with the power electronic converters are changing the phase that the power system dynamic is facing, okay? And coming back to this concept, as I say before, the IEEE realized the importance of including this new phenomenon. And last year, 2020, this technical report about stability definition and characterization include the new phenomena. And to be honest, the huge impact for the power system community here was that two new forms of instability were included in the stability definition. One of them, the converter-driven stability, and the other one, the resonant stability. The resonant stability was, for many years in the literature, we used to call those harmonic stability, but I will not discuss so much details here. What I can tell you is that the classical way to consider stability is included here in the right-hand side. In the right-hand side, we have the classical stability, we have the rotor angle, the frequency stability, the voltage stability. But this report coming from 2020 includes the resonant stability that I will not care so much here, but the very important for me is the converter-driven stability. Converter-driven stability refers to some phenomena that they are creating global instability in the electrical power system based on the interactions between the classical components in the electrical power system and the new power converters. And this kind of interaction can be fast interaction with a frequency characteristic from hertz to kilohertz, and the slow interaction coming from less than 10 hertz, okay? Now the question is, we know that the situation is we are reducing synchronous machine. We know that we are increasing the volume or the number of power electronic converters. Now, we understand that there are some issues. One of them is an issue related with converter-driven stability. Now, how do we solve those problems? Well, it's not me. Many people around the world is working in this topic for many years. And there is some consensus, I will say, that there are two possible paths to deal with a power-dominate converter power system, okay? They are what we call the short-term solutions. To be honest, I don't call this solution. I just say that this is mitigation situations. This is something that we have been dealing in several countries around the world for many years, Australia, GB, Ireland. We have been making changes on the grid codes. We have been trying to create more services. We have been trying to use some mitigation measures. And then we have on the right-hand side here what we call the long-term solutions. What are the typical long-term solutions, okay? One of them is one of the controllers that I will be discussing in a few minutes. It's enabled the power converters with some features that try to increase the inertia or try to make the system to cope with the low inertia. Another thing that I will not cover here, but is probably one of the hot topics, is this new control technique that we are using for converters. Well, it's not new, but it's fashioned right now, the grid forming control. And the other thing is including new controllers or develop new controller for the advanced use of renewables, storage, and any other kind of power electronic converters, okay? Well, we have here long-term solutions, we have short-term solutions. To be honest, today I will discuss some of the long-term solutions related with frequency control. In particular, what I will try to explain today is basically some controllers, frequency controllers that can be used in renewables, okay? Well, I believe all of you understand frequency control in electrical power system. All of you understand that the frequency is basically an electromechanical indicator, and this indicator is related to the active power balance. I mean the relationship between active power production and consumption. And inside the electrical power system, there are many actors, there are many components, And those components, some of them have the responsibility to cope with this balance, and to cope with this balance in several time scales. What I'm trying to tell you is that, for instance, in the case of the GP system, we have what we call the primary response, the secondary response, and the high frequency response. The primary response is basically a response that is provided by the generators, typically in a time scale that is related between 10 and 20 seconds. We have later the secondary, that is a longer time scale between 30 seconds and 30 minutes. And then we have the very fast response that is around 10 seconds, okay? When we have a system frequency disturbance, when we have a massive power imbalance, active power imbalance, the frequency behaves like this plot here on the bottom left. You can see here, this is a classical response coming from a frequency response coming from a classical system. You can see that there are several indicators. For instance, one of the very important indicators is how fast the frequency is going down, in this case, the FDT, or what we call rate of change of frequency, ROCoff. Another very important indicator for frequency response is the minimum frequency. And finally, probably less known, but also another indicator is the steady state frequency, okay? The ROCoff is extremely important for two reasons. It's telling you how fast the frequency is going down, but also when we are working with synchronous machine or any device that is synchronized to the grid, there is a possibility that this define how fast are changing the frequency, but also the rotational speed of the devices. ROCoff has a special impact on mechanical stresses, for instance, at steam turbines and so on. Minimum frequency is a very important indicator because the minimum frequency defines the point where the emergency control, frequency control, start to work. And there is a classical mechanism that we use to control the frequency in emergency cases that is called under frequency load shedding, trying to reestablish the balance between the generation and the demand. Well, what I'm trying to tell you is that in this case, the minimum frequency is a very important indicator because if the frequency goes so deep, we will have this activation of under frequency load shedding. And finally, we are disconnecting some customer from the service, creating problems from the economic point of view, but also from the reliability point of view, okay? Here I can divide, let me clean the screen. I can divide the system frequency response in several areas, what we call the primary frequency response, that is divided into sectors. The first one is what we call the inertial response, that is something that is extremely fast, coming from the kinetic energy stored in the rotor of the synchronous machine. Then when the frequency reaches the minimum or there is some time passed by after the under frequency event, some control actions are taken, specifically by the governors, and the governors try to recover the balance between active power generation and demand. And those three actions are basically what we, those two control actions are basically what we care in this presentation. Inertial response, natural response coming from the synchronous machine, basically releasing kinetic energy from the rotor. And here the governor action, that is a supplementary control in the synchronous machine, try to reestablish the balance between generation and demand and acting on the prime mover, okay? There are other control schemes that we can talk about in frequency control, the secondary control, the tertiary control, but I will not discuss those details in this presentation, okay? Now, the question is, how can we get some frequency response from renewables? And as I said before, if we have some frequency response, we have several indicators. Indicator number one, ROCoff. Indicator number two, transient frequency nadir. Indicator number three, steady state frequency. Well, in real life, we have multi-layer control, and this multi-layer control is dedicated to cope with one of those indicators. The primary control is basically a control that is extremely fast, is below 30 seconds, is automatic, is local. It's basically a control that is installed nearby the generator, okay? Secondary control is a global or centralized controller with a different time scale. It can be between seconds and minutes. And the tertiary control that typically has an economic impact and is again a wide area or a global control. Okay. Now, if we want to get those responses from renewables, for instance, from wind power, well, we need to think in similar way. We can talk about, for instance, in the case, a specific case of wind power, we can think about three different layers. The device layer, we are talking about inside the wind turbine. We can install some controllers over there. We can enable one of those indicators response. And then we have the second layer, the wind farm, that is collecting the response of those wind power, wind turbines, and going to the power system. And finally, the third layer, the slowest one, the global one, that is the power system layer, okay? In this presentation, I will discuss today only the first layer, the wind turbine. And when we want to cover frequency response from wind turbines, there are several controllers that we can think about. One of them is the inertia emulation control. The inertia emulation control is something extremely simple and is very, very simple to implement, especially in power electronic converters, because it's basically an additional control loop that we can create, okay? The inertia emulation is basically a controller, a control loop, that is sensing the frequency. There are many flavors for sensing the frequency, but it's sensing the frequency, calculating the derivative of that signal, and then creating or using again in order to replicate what we call the swing equation, okay? This controller is very simple. It's modifying the active power reference of the power converter, and this reference is coming from emulating the swing equation, okay? What is the advantages? This is extremely fast to implement, extremely simple to implement, and you can do it in any kind of wind turbine. What is the bad news? The bad news regarding the inertia controller, there are many, many drawbacks, okay? In fact, this is not one of my favorite. The first thing that I can notice is if you are sensing frequency and the frequency is coming from the system, you have a real noisy signal. And then when you use the derivative control, you are amplifying that noise. For that reason, you need to filter the signal. Yes, you can filter the signal, but when you are filtering the signal, you are creating some time delays, okay? As a consequence, the settings of this filter and also reducing the noise is a very interesting challenge for the wind turbine. Another aspect is related with the MPPT, that is related with the wind power, but I will discuss that in a few minutes, okay? Another controller that we can use for creating emulation in wind turbines is what we call the fast power reserve emulation. The fast power reserve emulation is an extremely simple controller. The controller, again, is acting on the active power reference of the power converter. That means this controller is extremely fast and extremely simple to implement. And what is the idea behind this controller? Well, if the wind turbine is dispatching or producing some power here, let's say this generation unit is 1 megawatt, and you are working at 0.8 megawatts, well, when the frequency controller detect that there is a change in frequency, the converter is switched to the rate power and maintain the rate power at time that is depending on the inertia moment of the system, okay? That is the idea here. The idea is we have some power production. When the under frequency event happens, we have a massive power increase until reaching the maximum power of the power converter and stay for a time that is defined by the inertia constant of the system. What is, again, one of the advantages? This is extremely fast to implement, very simple to implement. It's a couple of lines in the controller code. But one of the probably worst situation here is that is this controller is creating a DPDT, a rapid change in the active power that is huge. And with that, we are creating probably another disturbance inside the power system, okay? To be honest, I was a fan of inertia controller for quite a while. I did a few papers in 2011, 2012, 2006, and this is something very simple to implement, okay? The inertia controller, if we are using a wind turbine type 4, we have here the full converter scheme. We have on this side the grid side converter that is basically a rectifier. On the grid side, we have another converter that is the inverter. And it's extremely simple to implement in any power system analysis software. Sorry, I pressed the wrong button here. Give me a second. Yes, now I am back. And as you can see over here, I implemented this in a paper using the Xylem Power Factory. The controller was very simple. It was basically using the derivative term. In this case, I include a limiter. That limiter was later related with the mechanical properties of the wind turbine. I have a filter, I have a gain, and that was the reference that was included to the power converter. And then we use several simulations. We run many simulations with this. And the idea of this was assess several of the properties coming from this inertia emulation. And to be honest, one of the things that I like is that using inertia emulation, we were able, for instance, to avoid the use of the under frequency low shedding, okay? If the gain of this controller, this derivative controller, is appropriated, defined, we can avoid activating the under frequency low shedding. Probably you are wondering why this controller that is acting only on the rock off is able to has an influence on the minimum frequency. Well, the reality is that avoiding having a huge rock off allow the governors of the other machines to take over quickly and avoid reaching a so deep minimum frequency. That was the reason basically that motivated this research paper, okay? Inertia emulation has been in the market for many, many years. For instance, in 2011, we published a book chapter. In that book chapter, I presented some results coming from inertia emulation. In this case, it was the fast reserve emulation, fast active power reserve emulation that is coming from Enercon, the German wind turbine manufacturer. Okay, as I said before, you can see over here how the system is working before the under frequency event. When the under frequency event happens, you can see here, this is the reference signal coming to the controller, and this red plot over here, this red line over here, is basically the actual output power coming from the wind turbine, in this case 2 megawatts wind turbine, okay? This experiment was done by people from Enercon Germany, and they present those results in the Enercon magazine. And the conclusion of this is it's working, it's useful, it can be implemented into the real power system, okay? Let me move forward to tell you something. Inertia emulation is quite good, however, it's not the final solution. It's not the final solution because the system is not only losing rotational inertia. In reality, the electrical power system is losing several properties coming together with the synchronous machine. The synchronous machine, for many years, we have been using the machine, and as consequence, we forget
several of the very good properties coming with the synchronous machine. For instance, a synchronous machine has the possibility of providing high short circuit currents. For many decades, people were complaining about high short circuit currents, and then we start to use mechanism to reduce the short circuit currents. But the reality is that when power converters are installed inside the electrical power system, we are losing the capability for short circuit. And that has several effects. For instance, we are losing the robustness of the power system, and this means, for instance, it will be easier propagation for harmonics. But also, the massive problem is that the classical overcurrent protection will start to work. Because the classical overcurrent protection, non-directional overcurrent protection, require a massive change in the current in order to detect and locate the fault. And for that reason, what I'm trying to tell you is we are losing more things than just rotational inertia. For instance, we are changing reactive power support and many other things. Something that we have done a few years ago is that those frequency controllers start to be very attractive when we have the possibility of delivering active power, but also absorbing active power. A game changer was when the price of the batteries start to be reduced and the quality of those batteries start to be very helpful and very useful. And we start to assess frequency controller for battery energy storage. I believe it was 2015 or 16, we proposed the concept of fast active power control. The fast active power control is basically a frequency sensible controller that we install to provide a reference for the control loops of the battery energy storage. Okay, and this frequency controller has a very interesting structure. I will tell you in a minute, but basically we consider two different control action together, a proportional control action and a derivative control action. Okay. If you remember, when I was talking about the inertia emulation, the inertia controller is basically a derivative control action. Derivative control action increases noise, but is very fast to response. And proportional control action, the idea is that the response is based on what we used to call troops in the synchronous machine. For that reason, we propose this combination, having a proportional control action and derivative control action. But we stop using the word droop, and inertia. And the reason is because those constants, coefficients, or gains of those controllers, they can be optimized, they can be appropriately defined, and we can reach new goals in terms of frequency response. Here I am showing you, I forgot to move forward. Here in the next slide, right now is the proper slide, I am showing you the proportional control action. The proportional control action allow me to solve one of the issues related with the inertia controller, and that is that the inertia control require an activating mechanism. With the proportional control action, we include a dead band, and if the frequency is inside that dead band, there is no control action taken. And if the frequency go above or below this dead band, we have a proportional control action that is taken until the reference signal reach the saturation, the maximum power of the power converter. What is the advantage of this? Well, first, the response, the active power response, is smooth. You can see here, if the gain is very small, we can get this beautiful response over here. Of course, if we use a gain for this proportional control action, we can saturate the converter quite fast, and we are creating something similar to a step, okay? There are some advantages and advantages over there. However, I don't have all the time to discuss that. We are almost in 40 minutes. And then we have my less favorite control action, the derivative control action. A few minutes ago, this gain over here, the derivative gain was called H, or 2H, depending if you are using per unit or not. But In this case, the gain is basically a number that we can set up. And what we are using is just the derivative to add some speed up action in this controller. The good news is that the controller will respond very fast. And however, that will create saturation in the converter, reaching the maximum power. Okay. At the end, the control action that we propose is the combination of those two control actions. And as you can see over here, it's here. These control actions are combined here, the proportional control action, the derivative control action. We used to call this FAPIA, is fast active power injection. And we optimize the controller, and depending on the objective function that you define, for instance, we can minimize the steady state frequency, and if the objective function is minimizing the steady state frequency, we obtain some parameters for the proportional and the derivative control action. And then we try to optimize, and in fact we did, minimizing the deviation of the minimum frequency, try to avoid the underfrequency load shedding. And to do that, again, we use optimization. We obtain some set of settings, and that set of settings allow us to control the frequency response. Probably you are wondering, can you control the steady state frequency and can you control at the same time the minimum frequency? Yes, you can do it, but it's a quite tricky scenario, because when you try to optimize the minimum frequency, the steady state frequency typically go up as with the minimum frequency. Okay. Well, it's 42 minutes, almost 45, and it's time for closing remarks over here. Okay. I will close this presentation, probably open the door for many questions at the moment. Okay. I will present this schematic that I already present before, this block diagram. There are several signals and things over there. Many people are working on frequency control. Yes, frequency control is very important. There are many flavors on frequency control. We already use artificial intelligence, reinforced learning for frequency control, and so on. But the frequency controller is not alone. Many things we need to coordinate when we are trying to improve the frequency response. And for instance, one very important element is what we have on the DC side of this converter. Because depending of the type of technology that we have over there, the technology impose some sort of constraint on the frequency service that we can deliver. For instance, in one publication that we did, we use a multi-energy storage system. And the multi-energy system was the combination between supercapacitors, flywheels, and batteries. When you have different assets able to provide very fast response, you need to care about the energy that they are able to produce. To be honest, the supercapacitors, they can respond extremely, extremely fast, but the energy that they can deliver will not stay for long. Then we have, in time and scale, we have the flywheel. The flywheel is relatively fast, and they can provide some very fast response, but the energy is also limited. And finally, we have the battery. The battery, we want that they respond fast, but also we need to care about the rate of change of current and rate of change of power on the battery to avoid minimizing or reducing the life expectancy of the asset, okay? What I'm trying to tell you again is that depending of the technology, these technologies will provide some constraints, some limitations regarding frequency services provide. And finally, and probably very, very important, is also the power converter, okay? as I say early in my presentation, right now is a tendency to use two very fashion phrases. The old converters or traditional converter, voltage source converters, we use the name grid following converters. Any converter that use a synchronizing mechanism based on PLL is typically referred as a grid following converter. The grid following converter requires the signal coming from the grid in order to synchronize and inject power to the system. And right now, there are many people working on the new technique. Let's say that is not so new, but the grid following is basically using the voltage source converter to emulate or to replicate some sort of behavior coming from the synchronous machine, where we are providing not just power, also modifying the voltage in order to provide frequency. I didn't have time to cover the grid forming converter, but it's something that we need to be careful about the concept, okay? The grid forming converter, many people start to think, and also I am one of them, that is the grid forming the final solution for the problem of 100% power electronic converters? And there is no full understanding at the moment about the dynamic behavior of them that allow us to conclude this, okay? However, this is something that we can discuss in another time, with more dedication and more time, okay? For me, it's time to close this presentation. It's 47 minutes. Sorry, I went above 2 minutes. And yes, I am really open for question and answers. To be honest, I think that could be exciting with these colleagues here in the auditorium. Thank you.